The next item of business is a debate on motion 12004 in the name of Angus Robertson on Scotland's place in the European Union, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Angus Robertson to speak to and move the motion. Up to 15 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to move the motion that stands in my name. Tomorrow marks the fourth anniversary of Scotland being taken out of the European Union. Not only, of course, is Scotland removed from the EU, but we were forced out of the single market and forced out of the customs union. The United Kingdom government imposed an end to freedom of movement. It removed opportunities for our young people by abandoning the Erasmus scheme, and as we all knew would happen, they broke their promises once again to Scotland's fishing communities. In short, not only did the UK impose Brexit on Scotland, it imposed the hardest and the most damaging of Brexits. And all of this despite the fact that people in Scotland voted overwhelmingly to stay in the European Union. This Parliament expressed its support for remaining in the EU and the single market on many occasions, and yet the people of Scotland and their elected Parliament were ignored time and time again. So the Brexit referendum and its aftermath didn't just relate to the relationship between the UK and the EU, it revealed something fundamental about the very nature of the UK itself. The UK can no longer be described as an equal partnership of nations. It is a Westminster knows best state which routinely ignores the views of the people in Scotland, and that's democratically unsustainable. From a practical point of view, Brexit is an ongoing economic disaster. Leader of the UK Labour Party, Keir Starmer, says his priority is growth, 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 while unfortunately the obvious problem with that is his commitment to Brexit, Brexit, Brexit. Brexit has already increased inflation, Brexit has harmed trade, Brexit has reduced investment, and the list goes on. Scottish workers have lost income, and consumers are having to pay higher prices for food, making the cost of living crisis worse. A recent study from the National Institute of Economic and Social Research suggests that the UK economy is now estimated to be 2.5% smaller as a result of Brexit. So that impact equates to a cut of around £2.3 billion of public revenues for Scotland. Estimates from others, such as the Centre for European Reform, suggest the damage has been even worse. But that's not the end of it. Analysis by the Cambridge Econometrics estimates that the economic damage will continue, reaching 10% of gross value added by 2035. And of course, the impact of Brexit is not only economic. Brexit has severely reduced the opportunities for Scotland to collaborate with European partners on cross-border challenges. It's removed our ability to live and work freely across the EU, and we've lost out on access to EU exchanges and EU funds. And despite the huge benefits of European Union membership, the overwhelming evidence of the harm of Brexit and the predictions that the damage is only going to get worse, neither the Conservatives nor the Labour Party, sadly, nor even the Liberal Democrats, say they are fully in favour of rejoining the European Union. The Scottish Government takes a very different position. Scotland's interests need not continue to be wrecked by the UK government's approach to Brexit. The views of people in Scotland, as expressed through democratic elections to both Westminster and Holyrood, need not be able to be ignored or overridden. And the powers of our devolved institutions need not be able to be altered unilaterally by Westminster without the agreement of the Scottish government, this parliament, or indeed the people of this country. So the seventh paper in the Building a New Scotland series sets out the Scottish Government's alternative. And our vision is for an independent Scotland to join the European Union. Doing so offers Scotland the chance to regain what has been lost because of Brexit. It provides Scotland with what devolution cannot deliver, notably a framework to collaborate as equals with relationships governed by values, cooperation and by law. It means that for the first time, Scotland would be at the table advancing Scotland's interests directly in the European Union. And it would allow Scotland to contribute to the EU, bringing our expertise and resources to work towards shared goals. Of course.
Willie Rennie.
I think the Minister's bored with his own speech, because I think he's made the same one several times before. But nevertheless, has he drawn any evidence together about the impact of independence and ripping us out of the UK single market in the same way that he's drawn evidence about withdrawing the UK from the EU market. Surely he's done that basic homework.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Willie Rennie knows that the European Union single market is, I think I'm right in saying, seven times larger than the United Kingdom. So unlike Willie Rennie, I'm not in favour of economic dependency, which he is. He is keen on the Scottish economy remaining dependent on the UK single market. I'm much more confident that just like Ireland has been able to succeed economically and have a significantly higher GDP per head of population than the United Kingdom does, that I think we should take no lessons from the Liberal Democrats, who once upon a time were a pro-European party and sadly no longer are. I'm in favour of Scotland being part of the world's largest single market, with free movement of goods, of services, of capital and people. As I mentioned, the EU market is seven times... I want to make a bit more progress on this point, but I'll give way in later to Mr. Bibby. The EU market is seven times the size of the UK, almost 450 million consumers compared to the UK's 67 million. And Scottish businesses trading in the EU would have reduced barriers to trade, to free flows of data and less bureaucracy. This, of course, was a position that was supported by the Scottish Labour Party. Indeed, it was supported by Mr. Bibby's leader, Anna Sarwar, who said, and I'm quoting from him, that is why nobody can credibly claim that they want to protect jobs and not support membership of the single market and the customs union. I'm the only candidate in this contest, this is for leadership of the Scottish Labour Party, who supports permanent British membership of the European single market and the customs union. Perhaps Mr. Bibby would like, if I can give way to him now, to clarify if that is still the position of the Scottish Labour Party.
Neil Bibby.
Well, I'm not sure what the position of the SNP is in the customs union, because in 2019, during the Brexit votes, the SNP did not vote in favour of a customs union when their votes were critical in that matter. Talking about his own position, Angus Robertson, MP, in 2008 said the Lisbon Treaty, the current foundational document of the European Union, was unacceptable and a travesty. Does Angus Robertson, MSP, agree?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agreed at that time that people should have a view and should be able to cast a vote in favour of the European Union. That was my support for there being a referendum at that stage. I note Mr. Bibby didn't take the opportunity to confirm whether the Scottish Labour Party's position is now to rejoin the European single market in the customs union. I'd invite everybody to listen very closely to his speech to see whether he clarifies that in the debate later on. I've been making the point that Scottish businesses trading in the EU would have reduced barriers to trade, to free flows of data and less bureaucracy, and they would benefit from the EU's network of highly favourable trading relationships across the world. Trading would be cheaper, trading would be quicker, online shopping would be easier and it would be safer, and Scottish firms would be able to trade freely with more businesses and sell to more customers. Indeed, EU membership would provide more job choices and more career opportunities for people in Scotland. Our citizens would have access to more training, more research, more exchange opportunities, and the opportunity to improve language skills through the Erasmus Plus programme. We could attract and retain people from across the EU to sustain our businesses, our world-leading universities, and our public services. And Scotland would regain access to the EU's law enforcement tools, which help in the fight against cross-border crime and other threats. Our citizens' rights, such as guaranteed minimum working conditions and social security rights, would be protected by EU law. And of course, for the first time, Scotland would have a seat in our own right at EU decision-making tables. With a voice in debates and a vote on outcomes, Scotland could contribute directly to the policies of one of the most influential actors in global trade negotiations on international human rights and equality policies. And the evidence is clear. For countries of Scotland's size, EU membership works. So, people here have a choice. We can continue down the road of a Brexit-based UK economy which suffers from low growth, low productivity, high inequality and increasing isolation, or we can seek to emulate the success of comparable independent countries in Europe that are both wealthier and fairer than the UK. Countries like Finland, like Denmark, like Ireland. Indeed, the Financial Times reported in 2022 that, and I quote, far from simply losing touch with their Western European peers, last year the lowest earning bracket of British households had a standard of living that was 20% weaker than their counterparts in Slovenia. Perhaps the Conservative member would wish to reflect on that.
Cabinet Secretary, for taking the intervention. Scotland's exports, we know, are three times that of the EU. And the London School of Economics Centre for Economic Performance talked about the potential disruption with the rest of the UK could result in a reduction of Scottish income per capita of about 6.3%. Cabinet Secretary?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I noticed the member wasn't prepared to reflect on the relative economic decline of Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, as clearly demonstrated by the Financial Times. And I think that's a great shame, because I think it's there for everybody else to see. In terms of Scotland's opportunities, I've already, in answer to others, made the point that the single European market is significantly larger than that of the United Kingdom. And I have great hope. I have great expectations that Scottish business and exports, strong as they already are, could be even stronger, but within a much bigger international market, namely the single European market, whilst, of course, protecting and enhancing our position with trade on the rest of the nations on these islands that matter tremendously. But I think being part of that bigger single European market is absolutely key to reaching our full potential. Our commitment to the European Union is grounded in more than the practical benefits it brings, substantial though those are, and I have pointed those out to detractors in the chamber today. More fundamentally is our shared commitment to the EU's founding ethos of peace and security and the core values of human dignity, of democracy, of freedom and equality, human rights and the rule of law. In an age when intolerance and volatility seem to be on the rise, the values of the EU are more important than ever. And cooperating with the EU improves our ability to tackle challenges at home and amplifies our voice in international negotiations. The European Union has demonstrated that countries can deliver practical benefits for each other through peaceful cooperation. And so we will seek to rejoin the EU as soon as is possible after independence. Following 47 years as part of the EU, Scotland has a thorough understanding of how the EU operates, with developed networks amongst policymakers in the European Commission, the European Parliament, EU member states and their regions. And we are committed to EU values and already have a high level of alignment with European Union law. In currently reserved areas, Scotland would build capacity as required to ensure it would fulfil all EU membership obligations. And Scotland is therefore well placed to move through the EU's merit-based accession process smoothly and quickly. That view is shared by many very, very distinguished experts, for example, Fabian Zuleg, the chief executive of the European Policy Centre, who said that for Europe, and I quote, rejecting a country that wants to be in the EU, accepts all conditions, is willing to go through the appropriate processes and follows European principles, should be inconceivable. When asked about the level of support in the EU towards an independent Scotland joining the EU, the former president of the European Council and now the Prime Minister of Poland, Donald Tusk, said, and I quote, "Emotionally, I have no doubt that everyone will be enthusiastic here in Brussels and more generally in Europe." So apart from anything else, we will rejoin not simply as a country with much to gain, but as one which has much to contribute. And just as the EU has lots to offer Scotland, so Scotland has much to contribute to the EU as a member state. Our vibrant culture would make an important contribution to a dynamic and forward-looking EU. Our academic sector is a leading source of innovation and research and could help deliver new technologies of EU-wide importance. And our strengths in renewable energy could help contribute to the transition to net zero. Reaching net zero is an environmental, moral and security imperative. It will help us to reduce our dependence on gas and oil imports from around the world. And Scotland's large sea area and high average wind speeds mean that we have a key role to play. Our significant offshore wind and tidal energy potential could help the EU deliver its sustainable growth strategy. And Scotland is already home to the world's leading wave and tidal test centre, the world's largest planned tidal stream array, and according to its makers, the world's most powerful tidal stream turbine. So Scotland is amongst the best-placed nations in Europe to deploy carbon capture and storage due to our unrivaled access to vast carbon dioxide storage potential in the North Sea. We could also support the EU's priorities to develop the offshore grid and renewable energy potential in the North Sea.
It's widely recognised that green hydrogen has a crucial role to play in decarbonising heavy transport and energy intensive industries, and Scotland's surplus hydrogen production could help the EU achieve its hydrogen targets as part of its transition towards renewables. We also see it as a way of enabling ourselves and our European partners to collective decisions which reflect on Scotland's priorities. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, our paper provides the evidence of what the people of Scotland have known all along. EU membership is central to Scotland's future economic, political, security and social prospects. No wonder that in Scotland people voted decisively to remain in the EU in 2016, and no wonder that polling undertaken since the 2016 referendum has consistently found large majorities in favour of EU membership. That's why I believe Scotland's future is best served as being part of the EU. The UK government neither got the fantastical deal that they promised, nor is willing to acknowledge that being out with the EU single market and customs union is dragging the economy down. Despite the evident damage that Brexit is causing, given the position of the main parties at Westminster, the only route back to the European Union is for Scotland to become an independent member state, and that, Presiding Officer, is why Scotland needs independence. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Members will wish to know that there is time in hand for interventions. We'll be as generous as possible in that regard. And I now call on Donald Cameron to speak to and move Amendment 12004.2 up to 11 minutes. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I move the amendment in my name? The title of this debate, An Independent Scotland in the EU. Here we are yet again debating a hypothetical wrapped in speculation and inside a misconception. Of course.
Just to correct the record, of course, Mr. Officer, that is not the title of the debate, it's Scotland's place in the European Union. That's going to be an important point as this debate continues, I fear.
Here.
Donald Cameron.
Well, I thank Jamie Hepburn for that very important intervention. Here we are yet again debating a hypothetical wrapped in speculation and inside a misconception, to misquote Winston Churchill. Because as the COVID inquiry takes evidence at this very moment about the conduct of the SNP government, its ministers and its civil servants, tries to get to the bottom of what went on during the pandemic, what does the SNP government come to this chamber to debate? The hypothetical question of an independent Scotland joining the EU. Now, it is very tempting to take the bait, Presiding Officer. I must confess, I always enjoy debating with Angus Robertson and Jamie Hepburn. They give as good as they get, and they manage to do so with grace and humour. And it's tempting to point out that about a third of SNP voters supported Brexit and voted that way. Over a million Scots, of course, voted to leave the European Union. SNP luminaries such as Alex Neil, no less. Now, it is tempting, Presiding Officer, to point out that great minds like him and many other nationalists see that it is simply illogical for those in the independence movement to complain about the shackles of Westminster on the one hand, but then support being chained to Brussels on the other. And it's tempting to point out that there are those in the independence movement, like the former First Minister, Alex Salmond, and his Alibi Party, who recognise the one viable path for an independent Scotland would be membership of EFTA, not the EU. Now, these are all rabbit holes, Presiding Officer, that I am very tempted to go down. But I won't, because rather like Alice in Wonderland, who of course went down the original rabbit hole, to do so would be to enter the realms of fiction and of fantasy. And as Willie Rennie was right, he said the Cabinet Secretary might be getting bored with the speech that he'd made because he made it so many times before. I mean, we've all made these speeches many times before. Because back in the real world, there are many more pressing problems that the people of Scotland want to see addressed. Problems such as the fact that there are nearly 830,000 patients waiting for NHS treatment across Scotland. Problems such as the fact that rural schools are twice as likely to be in poor condition compared to urban schools. The Highland Council area has the poorest school estate in Scotland and is also happens to be bottom of the league table for literacy and numeracy. Problems such as the fact that more than 71,000 violent crimes were recorded last year, the highest total since 2011 to 2012. These are the issues that people really care about, and they are issues that are getting worse, not better, because of this government's narrow focus on the Constitution.
Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, Mr Cameron has listed a lot of worthy things that we would all like to do, but does Mr Cameron recognise that the Centre for European Reform estimates that due to date, due to Brexit, that has cost the UK Treasury some £40 billion in tax receipts? £40 billion that could have been spent on the public services that he describes?
Donald Cameron.
Well, I thank Mr Stewart for the intervention. Of course, an independent Scotland would incur huge costs. And he is, and like many of his party members, are incapable of recognising the severe economic damage that independence would do to people in Scotland. Because there aren't just glaring problems, presiding officer, in our NHS, in our schools, in our justice system. On housing, the SNP failed to meet its 50,000 affordable homes target on time in the last parliament. In the Highlands and Islands, available and affordable housing is at such a critical shortage that local authorities, such as Argyll and Bute, declared a housing emergency last year. And I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will have seen the Herald newspaper is dedicating this week its editions to publishing that paper from my region to highlight the acute issues of depopulation in the Highlands and the devastating consequences that can bring. What were this government's solutions? A botched islands bond, which it scrapped shortly after consultation. A rural housing fund, of which only half has been allocated. A rural affordable homes for key workers fund that has secured zero properties almost 9 months since it was established. And on transport, a failure to dual the A9 despite promising to do so in multiple election manifestos. The national disgrace that is this government's ferry replacement policy, with two vessels sitting in a dockyard on the Clyde, four times over budget and more than 6 years late. On infrastructure, a failure to roll out superfast broadband to every home and business in Scotland, despite a cast-iron pledge to do so by 2021. Now, presiding officer, I'm beginning to understand why the SNP government brings forward debates like the one we are having today, rather than trying to defend such an appalling domestic record. It is nothing to say about the issues that people expect this government to deal with, and it is becoming increasingly clear that people across Scotland are growing weary of these excuses and distractions. Now, of course, when the SNP Green government works with the UK government rather than against it, so much can be achieved. Instead of using this debate to complain about a democratic UK-wide referendum result that has long since been settled, we should be debating about how we can find new and better ways of working with our partners in the EU. And it's now nearly a year ago that the Prime Minister agreed the landmark Windsor framework with the European Commission President, providing a new legal and constitutional framework for the UK's relationship with the EU. And I believe that this past year has shown that the Windsor framework and the associated negotiations around that has instilled a much more positive relationship with our close friends and allies in the EU, one that I hope continues to prosper and grow. Let us hope that the news overnight from Northern Ireland is a new positive chapter in that story. Now, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee has recently begun an inquiry into the trade and cooperation agreement ahead of its review in 2026. And as the Cabinet Secretary himself has recognised in the past, at official level, Scottish Government officials and UK Government officials work well and constructively on a number of issues. So rather than breaking away from the world's most successful union and becoming a smaller state with less influence in the EU, Scotland is so much better served as part of our United Kingdom. And let me point out one aspect of that. There are many. As part of the UK, 500,000 Scottish jobs, around one in every four, is supported by the fact that 60% of our trade exports go to the rest of the UK. That's approximately £48 billion worth. As part of the UK, Scotland has access to 200 UK-wide public institutions. As part of the UK, Scotland can use the pound, one of the world's strongest currencies, which ensures that pensions are protected and we are the world's sixth largest economy. As part of the UK, Scotland remains at its most influential. Our membership of the UK, of the UN Security Council, the G7, the G20, etc. I could go on. That is why people continue to support Scotland's place in the UK. And we on these benches not only respect that, but we will continue to fight to protect that. Presiding Officer, the SNP may want to keep fighting battles that have long since ended, but the Scottish people are tiring of this government's lethargy and incompetence. They want a parliament that is focused on solving the challenges of our time and not focused on issues settled in referendums 8 or 10 years ago. What a crying shame it is the SNP continues to bring forward debates such as this rather than focusing on the issues that really matter to people.
Thank you. I now call on Neil Bibby to speak to and move amendment 12004.1. That's 9 minutes, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm not sure if the Cabinet Secretary is, as I am, a fan of fantasy football. If not, I would encourage him to become one, because I think he would be better spending 10 minutes of a weekend playing that fantasy game than subjecting the rest of us to hours of this exercise in fantasy politics today. Hours of valuable parliamentary time taken up with a debate on a paper few have read and even less are interested in. These papers do not focus on the priorities of the people of Scotland, are a waste of taxpayers' money, and they aren't even convincing their own supporters. And therefore, it's a further waste of parliamentary time debating them today. Don't take my word for it. Even former SNP Cabinet Secretary Alex Neil said recently the Scottish Government need to ditch the crap and get focused entirely on the people's priorities by delivering better services and supporting the Scottish people. The SNP should stop, he said, constantly contemplating our navels. I agree with Mr. Neil on that. Presiding Officer, this is a transparent and desperate distraction from the SNP's mounting political problems and from the issues that urgently matter to the people of Scotland. Because the truth is, this Parliament and the Scottish people don't need a made-up debate on Europe today. If we are concerned, as the motion states, about what best serves Scotland's economic, social and political future, then we should be debating more pressing matters. We should be debating the cost of living crisis that continues to afflict the communities and families across our country. We should be debating the winter crisis in our NHS and spiralling waiting lists. We should be debating the outrageous and savage cuts inflicted on local councils by this Scottish Government and the degrading of our public services. At a time when the Scottish Government is spending nearly £2 million on the production of these papers, day centres for adults with learning disabilities in Renfrewshire are under threat of closure and merger due to this government's budget cuts. Our most vulnerable adults face losing lifeline services they rely on, whilst this government wastes vital resources on this charade. And of course, recent weeks have revealed, as Donald Cameron mentioned, the mass deletion on an industrial scale of WhatsApp messages by this government, a clear attempt to thwart the work of the UK COVID inquiry, and a massive betrayal of COVID bereaved families and of the Scottish public. Why aren't we debating that? Presiding Officer, it's not just WhatsApps that have disappeared, but so too has trust in this Scottish Government. We know why we aren't debating these issues, Presiding Officer, because rather than face their own record, their own failings and dearth of ideas, this Government seeks to engage in a transparent diversion and yet another desperate attempt to pretend to their own supporters they have a plan when they don't. An attempt to create what we might even call a good old-fashioned rammy to breathe some life into the SNP's dwindling poll numbers. And it is disappointing. Presiding Officer, like Domino Cameron, I have considerable respect for Mr Robertson and Mr Hepburn. I think they're better than this, but this is a symptom of a party that has lost its way after 17 years in government. I worked constructively with Mr Hepburn when he was Minister for Small Business. He did an important job in that brief, and in my view, he did that well. Now, however, Mr Hepburn is unfortunately in a non-job preparing glorified talking points in non-debates. And just a few weeks ago, I had a constructive meeting with the Cabinet Secretary, where we discussed a range of useful ideas and issues in relation to matters affecting the culture sector. That's what this Cabinet Secretary and all ministers should be doing, using the powers to effect real change now. To hold this position, these positions, is a great responsibility and a great privilege. But stuff like this, however, Presiding Officer, is a dereliction of duty. Just a few weeks ago, the Cabinet Secretary was praising the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee for its unanimous report on devolution post-Brexit. He knows that the committee, as we speak, is embarking on an inquiry into the trade and cooperation agreement with the EU. If we want to debate Europe, surely it is upon publication of the committee's report that we should do so. Let the committee do its work and let us debate the issue in full proper possession of the facts and evidence. Nevertheless, we are here, presiding officer. And let's be clear, the Tory government have made a complete mess of Brexit and of much else. Their botched Brexit has left no one happy, even Brexit supporters. They have burned bridges with our allies and partners and left businesses and trade and deal with Europe drowning in a sea of red tape. They have presided over economic calamity and political chaos. It is a dismal and disgraceful record. But the answer, presiding officer, isn't yet more years of social division, constitutional upheaval and costly economic damage. Brexit itself should act as a warning of the consequences of withdrawing oneself from an economic and political union for the sake of a constitutional obsession, particularly one which does not command the support of the majority of Scotland's people. I'll take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
In an early intervention, I asked Mr Bibby what the position of the Scottish Labour Party was, and he wasn't able or prepared to answer then, so will he do so now? Is it the position of Anas Sarwar and the Scottish Labour Party that it is in support of permanent British membership of the European Single Market and Customs Union? It's a yes or a no.
We will seek to fix the Tories' Brexit mess, and I'll come on to the details of how we want to have greater cooperation with our European partners. But the SNP once ignore the inconvenient truth about the customs union we have with the rest of the UK. The fact that we share a land border with the rest of the UK, a currency and so many institutions. Angus Robertson talked earlier about how big and important the single market was, but we neglected to mention that the UK makes up 61% of Scotland's export market. Their plans would make Brexit look like a cakewalk. What is more, the Scottish Government's own analysis indicates that for an independent Scotland to join the EU would take years and possibly many, many years of complex negotiations. The Scottish Government should be honest about these trade-offs and honest about these costs. No, I'm going to make progress. Presiding officer, people need change, and that process can start by booting the Tories out and electing a UK Labour government. Labour has set out practical and achievable solutions to fix the Tories' Brexit mess with a better relationship with the EU and improvements to the TCA. We need to use the scheduled review of the TCA to tear down unnecessary trade barriers. We also need to support our world-leading services and scientists by seeking mutual recognition of professional services. Labour will seek a better deal for financial services and a new defence and security pact with the EU. In the realm of culture, Labour set out clearly its intentions to fix the visa touring issues for musicians and artists and to seek an EU cultural touring agreement. People also want a wider programme of economic and social change. The creation of GB Energy and a New Deal for working people are just two important examples of practical, deliverable change that can improve people's lives. And that, presiding officer, is in sharp contrast to the SNP. The SNP aren't principled on Europe, they are opportunists. The Nationalists opposed EU membership in the 1975 referendum. In 2014, they were willing to forsake our place in Europe. Let's not forget the SNP spent more money in the Shetland by-election than they spent during the entirety of the EU referendum campaign. And in 2019, they did not even vote in favour of a customs union during the Brexit votes. And their policy position on this remains unclear and confused. I asked the Cabinet Secretary about his own comments about the Lisbon Treaty being completely and utterly unacceptable and a travesty. This seems hard to square with the more recent enthusiasm to render an independent Scotland subject to that treaty. The Government wants an independent Scotland to join the EU but seem ambivalent on whether or not they are prepared to join the Euro, something which many experts agree would be essential. And the Government's own internal analysis released through FOI shows it would take years for an independent Scotland to even join the EU, years of vast economic upheaval about which the Scottish Government is rarely candid with the Scottish public. That's why people can't take these debates and these papers seriously. In closing, presiding officer, the sad reality is that this debate has more to do with the SNP government's internal politics than it does with actual matters of substance and of pressing concerns to the people of Scotland. The people of Scotland deserve better. They deserve governments at both Scotland and UK levels that will deliver on their priorities and tackle their concerns.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. I now call on Willie Rennie to speak to and to move Amendment 1 to 004.3. Mr. Rennie.
I always listen very carefully to the Cabinet Secretary. The more I listened to him this afternoon, though, the more it had echoes of Jacob Rees-Mogg. And this is not some insult, throwaway comment. If you actually look at the detail of what the Cabinet Secretary was talking about, there are very many similar arguments to those that were made by the Brexiteers. A deadweight UK, slow economic growth. That was what Nigel Farage and Jacob Rees-Mogg said about the EU at the time. The fact that there's a huge market elsewhere in the world, exactly the same argument that the Cabinet Secretary has made this afternoon is the one that made by Jacob Rees-Mogg. And then overruling our democracy. Equally an argument that the Cabinet Secretary and Jacob Rees-Mogg have frequently made. So there are many similar echoes between the two arguments. It's the two forms of nationalisms that are taking over this debate. And I think the one thing that we have learnt over the last few years, that putting up barriers causes economic damage rather than creating economic opportunity. We've seen that the only real tangible benefit that we've had from Brexit has been the trade agreement with Australia and New Zealand. And that was criticised by the Agriculture Secretary at the very time when it was going through. So we know that there are no real benefits from Brexit. We've seen none of the tangible things that Jacob Rees-Mogg talks about. And we know that that would be exactly the same if we were ever to be in the unfortunate position of breaking up the United Kingdom. Because I've noticed in recent weeks that several members of the SNP benches have been getting exercised by the new labels that are being stuck onto UK produce, not for EU, which is the consequence of the Windsor Agreement, the Northern Ireland Protocol, to deal with the Green Lane issues. But this is not something to point to the failure of Brexit, which I think, of course, it is. But it is also a warning about what would come if we were ever to be in the unfortunate situation of breaking up the United Kingdom, because we would be replacing those labels with not for UK produce. That would be what would be on our produce in Scotland. So the thing that we very much get angry about now is exactly the thing that would happen if we were ever to break up the United Kingdom. So I think the SNP should just be careful with what they campaign about and what they claim they are in support of. Because we have got I think the Cabinet Secretary and I agree about the National Institute's assessment of the impact of Brexit, the 2 to 3% GDP drop, which is £850 per person. That is a big economic disadvantage to citizens in this country, on top of the damage of Ukraine and also COVID. But it's also brought difficulties in terms of attracting workers for important sectors like social care and the NHS, and it's caused division. We saw that tensions were raised again last night in Northern Ireland with the protests outside the DUP meeting. So we know there are tensions, we know there's economic damage, we know there is a shortage of workers, but we've got to ask ourselves a question. What do we do next? Do we repeat those mistakes? Or do we learn the lessons? Now, I'm determined that we learn the lessons. I was opposed to Brexit. I'm still opposed to Brexit. Of course, I want to be in the European Union. I don't want to have gone through the last few years of arguing endlessly about pointless things that don't make any advantage for our country. What I'm learning now is how do we get back to a position where we can reduce the economic damage, where we can get the workers back into our NHS and social care sectors, and where we can eradicate the division. That's what I'm wanting to try and do. And the gradualist approach has got to be the one that we are in favour of. That's something the SNP used to be in favour of, but they don't seem to be anymore. But we need to have a gradualist approach of making sure that, for instance, on REACH, that we bring UK REACH together on the chemicals assessment, together with the European REACH. There's hardly any difference between the two either. So let's get them working together. Let's have mutual recognition on trades and professions so that a worker from Ochtermuchty who's a joiner can go off to Brussels and do exactly the same job over there. That should be the opportunity that we are presenting for people. We need to look at the veterinary checks of eradicating some of the bureaucracy round about that as well. These are the practical steps that we should be taking, together with implementing powers that we said we were going to utilise. For instance, on the TAIF scheme, which is the replacement for Erasmus in Wales. Now, just here, we have a pilot, and a pilot that was delayed. So young people in Scotland are being deprived of an opportunity that the SNP said in their manifesto that would be provided, and they failed to deliver that. Whereas in Wales, there are students going to 23 European Union countries. They are going to 40 countries in the rest of the world, thanks to the programme that's been put in place in Wales. But in Scotland, nah, we're not interested, because it's not really the slogan that we're really after anymore. We were able to use Erasmus to try and make our arguments for independence, but no longer are interested because it doesn't suit the case anymore. And the Cabinet Secretary said he would take no lectures from me about Brexit. Well, I'm going to lecture him about this because he needs to remember, as Neil Bibby quite rightly pointed out, that they were more interested in the Shetland by-election than they were in the European referendum. They spent more money up there than in the whole of Scotland. The whole of Scotland, they spent a fraction of the money. Now, that doesn't look like a pro-European party to me. And Alex Salmond, I remember this at the time. Alex Salmond, remember, he used to be the leader of the SNP. No, not just now. I'm just making this very powerful argument. So Alex Salmond, I remember, he was more obsessed about attacking the UK government than he was about making a positive case for Europe during that referendum. And I remember two direct interventions. The only interventions from Alex Salmond in that European referendum was to attack the UK government. So they don't really care about Europe. It's only being used for their advantage as much as they can. So we need to make sure that we make the positive case for Europe by working closely with our neighbours in Europe to undo the damage, the economic damage and the division, and make sure we can get the workers for the UK that we need. Let's not repeat the mistakes with independence.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. I think we need to hear you move your amendment.
Very true. I'll move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. And we now move to the open debate. And I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Maurice Golden. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I was trying to intervene on Mr. Rennie there. I just find his argument about what we spent on the referendum, I think he forgets that we won it here in Scotland by a huge margin. So with 64% not enough for you, with 88% of the vote in Scotland going for Europe, this argument about we didn't do enough, I think it's evident that the people of Scotland wanted to stay in Europe. There was much furore last week when British negotiators walked away from the trade talks from Canada. And while there were concerns raised in news segments by food producers and whisky companies, what wasn't reported was that if we had not left Europe on the campaign based of the lies and the othering of European neighbours, yep, our producers would be enjoying the Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement, CETA, which is a modern and progressive EU trade arrangement offering the EU more and better opportunities in Canada. Now, I sit as convener of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee, and myself and Donald Cameron sit as observers on behalf of this Parliament on the PPA. The PPA is composed of a delegation of UK House of Commons and Lords representatives and members of the European Parliament. And the Assembly has discussed on many occasions, and indeed made some progress on a number of the post-Brexit concerns that have been raised in the Chamber this afternoon. And the Windsor Agreement did bring some meeting of minds in these areas. So we now have participation back in Horizon and Copernicus programmes, which we gave up with Brexit. We have discussed youth mobility and exchange, which we gave up with Brexit. And we have discussed touring artists and the burden on the multiple visas and cabotage, which did not apply before Brexit. So it seems that we are spending our time picking and choosing to get back the very rights that we inconceivably gave up when the UK left Europe. So where is the big Brexit bonus? And as has been shown in the chamber this afternoon, there just isn't one. It's led to our economy suffering from rising costs, borders to trade, and from the inability to recruit and retain valuable employees into our own economy. Our few European friends no longer enrich our communities in the way they once did. And presiding officer, plans for energy interconnectors, security issues, unrest on the European continent and in Gaza, all of this brings our world closer together. And yet, the Brexit disaster has left UK isolated on the fringes of Europe. And as I said, the Scottish people did not want this. It has happened against their wills. And even when we tried to get some of the benefits afforded to Northern Ireland for very good and understandable reasons, that was denied to Scotland. So we no longer have access to the European free market. Presiding officer, the Royal Society of Scotland is conducting the Europe Initiative. It has now held 10 events and a series under the RSE in Scotland. This is a project that looks at the future relationship between the United Kingdom and Europe, which is, they say, still unsettled. And at the same time, they recognise Europe itself is undergoing substantial change. And we have to look closer to home for distinct Scottish issues and options. So it's providing regular analysis of these issues, drawing on academic research. It's examining the policy and institutional options for responding to some of the challenges and engaging dialogue with government, business and civil society in Scotland. So it's somewhat churlish to suggest that this is not an appropriate place to be examining these very issues in our country's Parliament. We also have seen established the Scottish Council of Global Affairs. Glasgow University, Edinburgh University and St Andrews University, providing a non-partisan hub for expertise on international issues. And if I quote Professor Phillips O'Brien, who's the Chair of Strategic Studies at the University of St Andrews, he says it's time Scotland had a rigorous, non-partisan, people-focused Global Affairs Institute that can bring together brilliant researchers with a range of groups from across our society. These are the very best minds of our country who are looking at our future, looking at Scotland's place in Europe, the motion we are discussing today. And it's really important that we in this chamber should be able to come to this open-minded with a view to discussing all the ways forward for Scotland. We will disagree constitutionally, but what we cannot ignore is that Brexit has been an absolute disaster for our country, and that we must all come together and look to the future and the options open to our country. I believe the best option is an independent Scotland and a return to the heart of European politics. Others will have other ideas, but let's discuss them and not be talking about the past and what people did in 1975. This is the future, and it's a future with Ukraine as a possible member of the European Union. We should remember what's happening in our world and look to Scotland's future and that European Union too. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Adamson. I now call Maurice Golden to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The last time I debated one of these prospectus for independence papers, it was to discuss creating a modern constitution for an independent Scotland. In this paper, we heard that Scotland would be adopting a new fantasy constitution, which was to be triggered by a fantasy independence referendum, which will then trigger the adopting of a fantasy interim constitution before another fantasy referendum to adopt a permanent fantasy constitution. I hope that all made sense. It's quite hard to keep track of all the fanciful claims that have been made in these prospectuses on independence papers. Happy to.
Karen Adam.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. I want to ask the member if he believes that a question of fantasy or statement of fantasy could be vote no to stay in the EU.
Morris Golden.
I think the disappointing aspect from the member is not representing her own constituents, because in 2016 the SNP promised to reduce journey times on rail from Aberdeen to Edinburgh and Glasgow by over 20 minutes, but just 3% of that budget has been delivered so far. I am sure the members' constituents up in the North East are really disappointed by the fantasy promises of the Scottish Government. And just last month, in response to another one of these papers, the First Minister claimed that families would be £10,000 better off under an independent Scotland. But previous to becoming First Minister, he also suggested that these prospectus for independence papers were a waste of time. And he is right. They are a waste of time. Of all the many issues we could be debating here today, it is this one. But unfortunately, the SNP have a real habit with their debates of ducking scrutiny by avoiding the issues that really matter to the people of Scotland. Happy to.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I mean, he suggests we're seeking to avoid scrutiny. This is a Scottish Government publication. We've published this using Scottish Government resources entirely legitimately. We've got a mandate to do so. We've brought it here for debate so it can be scrutinised. Why doesn't he up his game and actually engage with the subject matter?
Morris Golden.
These papers are a waste of money. That's the fundamental point. The Scottish Government are paying £1.5 million a year to civil servants in their Constitutional Futures Division to work on these prospectus for independence papers and similar projects. And it's no surprise that the SNP have chosen the subject of EU membership for one of these papers, as it's one of their favourite subjects for grievance-filled bluster. Take the bluster upon which the Scottish Parliamentary Continuity Bill was introduced. The SNP would have had you believe that it was the most important piece of legislation passed by the Scottish Parliament since devolution. Legislation upon which the Scottish Government's default position would be to align to new EU law as it was introduced. Despite the numerous opportunities to do so, the Scottish Government have only once chosen to align to newly introduced EU law and have provided no explanation as to why they haven't aligned to every other new EU law that has been introduced. But a lot of times with this Government, you can learn more from the things they don't do. In the same vein with their vision for an independent Scotland in the EU paper, like all good propaganda exercises, it is far more interesting to know what it doesn't say. It claims Scotland would have access to the world's largest single market with reduced barriers to trade. But any reduced barriers to trade would come with increased barriers with Scotland's actual largest single market in terms of trade with the UK, which is a source of 67% of Scottish imports and responsible for over 500,000 Scottish jobs, almost four times the number of jobs linked to trade with the EU. The paper also fails to mention the EU's requirement of a 3% deficit, and that Scotland currently has a deficit of 9%. And as for currency, it's anyone's guess as to what the paper is actually saying about currency. Of course, this is one of the major issues the SNP has never had a coherent answer for. The paper states the Scottish Government would apply to join the EU as soon as possible after independence, while continuing to use sterling at the point of application. So an independent Scotland will apply to the EU whilst using sterling. It then says Scotland would, as soon as practicable, move from sterling to having its own currency, a new Scottish pound. The process of establishing a Scottish pound would be closely aligned with the process of rejoining the EU. So during the application process, whereby Scotland's deficit is already three times higher than the EU limit, Scotland will be creating the new mythical Scottish pound just in time for EU accession. The paper states that we would then be able to keep the mythical Scottish pound as long as we want, and that other countries have done this, so we could too. But the paper fails to also state that countries who have kept their currency have done so with existing currencies, not newly created mythical ones. So, who knows what the answer is? We could be using sterling, the mythical Scottish pound, or the euro. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, the SNP won't let these small details get in their way of their constitutional obsessions. I urge members to support the amendment in the name of Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Golding. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by CoCab Stewart. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Scotland may be physically at the northwest of Europe, but we have always been spiritually and economically at the heart of Europe. And you can see that from the history of my own city of Aberdeen, where for centuries we were trading with the Hanseatic League, as were other parts of our nation. Our position at the gates of the Atlantic allowed us to form a bridge between Europe and America. We sat on the Baltic trade route from the Americas across the North Sea to the Low Countries, Germany, Scandinavia, and onto the Baltic states. This European trade was vital to the development of modern Scotland. And despite the efforts of the UK government, in the past, it must not remain. Trade with the EU must be our future. The single market, a cornerstone of the EU, is not a romantic notion, but a tangible engine of economic growth. Access to 500 million consumers opens doors for Scottish businesses, unleashing their potential to compete and thrive. And during his contribution, Mr. Rennie spoke of the fact that 61% of our trade is with the rest of the UK. And next year he may stand up and say 62% or 63% or 64%. And some folk in this chamber seem to think that that's a good thing. That is a very bad thing because it shows our exporting capacity to Europe and to the rest of the world is shrinking and that we have an over-reliance on trade within these islands alone. That's not good for anyone. It's not good for Scotland, it's not good for England, it's not good for Wales, it's not good for Northern Ireland either. I'll give way to Mr. Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
Can I ask him, who's been in charge of the Scottish Government for the last 16 years that's presided over that?
Kevin Stewart.
As Mr. Rennie well knows, the difficulty that there is the fact that the large part of the levers of power when it comes to the economy is with the UK Government. And beyond that, we have seen a situation where trade with other areas has shrunk because of Brexit, a Brexit that Mr. Rennie and his party now seem to support. And to quote his leader, Ed Davey, he said that rejoining the EU is for the birds. I think rejoining the EU is for the wise, not the birds. I will stick with that. As I said, access to over 500 million consumers opens doors for Scottish businesses, unleashing their potential to compete and to thrive. Brexit-erected barriers have dampened exports and are stifling innovation. And it's no coincidence that UK growth started to fail even faster with the Brexit vote. And despite the massive deficient spending by the UK government reaching its peak with Trussonomics and the disastrous mini-budget, Britain's growth remains insipid. Now, I mentioned to Mr. Cameron, who is no longer here, that the Centre for European Reform estimates that to date, Brexit has cost the UK £40 billion in tax receipts, which, to the surprise of no one, matches the £46 billion in tax hikes carried out by Rishi Sunak. It's quite simple. If the resources to fund our public services don't come from trade and business, it comes from our back pockets. It's that simple. And like Mr. Cameron, I want to see more money spent on public services. There's probably no one, well, there's probably a few Tories actually, but next to no one in this chamber who do not want to see more spend on our public services. But Brexit has harmed that tax take, which means that there is less money to spend on the NHS, to spend on education, and to spend on infrastructure. We, Presiding Officer, must look to not just trading with 60 million people on these islands, because that is never going to compensate for being able to trade with 500 million people in the rest of Europe. And as I say, it is taxpayers who are left to pick up the Brexit bill for that lack of trade. Now, the British government tries to tell us that if we stick a Union Jack and not for sale on the EU on everything, that magically is bigger than that 500 million, but it's not. Scotland's trade, Scotland's place, and Scotland's future has to be with that 500 million and that openness to Europe and to the world. But how do we achieve that, Presiding Officer? Well, we should look again at that traditional Baltic trade route and follow the example of the Baltic states. They threw off the shackles of a decaying empire and took their place alongside the other independent countries in Europe. And that's what Scotland should do. We should give up on broken Brexit Britain and stand free as an independent nation within the European Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Cocab Stewart, be followed by Alec Riley. Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Europe is an ideal for which one must be prepared to fight. These are the words of Simone Veil, the late French politician and Holocaust survivor. We have just marked Holocaust Memorial Day, and it would be remiss of us not to consider exactly how the European project came about. Out of the ashes of war, where so many lives were torn apart, nations across the continent yearned to build a better future. One which preserved the right of national sovereignty, but saw beyond rigid borders and isolationism, with each allied nation working together on common policy areas such as food production, justice, security, environmental protections, and the promotion of human rights. The European Union, as it is today, is the home of 27 member states, around 450 million people. It's a cooperation of nations three times the size of the Russian Federation, a highly influential and formidable player on the global stage, of which, sadly, we are no longer a part. No longer a part of the single market, providing frictionless trade with our nearest international neighbours. No longer enjoying freedom of movement, enriching our citizens with broader horizons. The ability to live, work, and even fall in love in new surroundings. And shockingly, no longer a part of the Erasmus programme, which gave students across our continent the invaluable opportunity to live and learn in a different nation, experience different cultures, and learn different languages. Instead, I believe it is replaced with the vastly inferior UK Turin scheme, which, unlike Erasmus Plus, doesn't even cover tuition costs. I will take the intervention.
Jeremy Balfour.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to the member. Would we enter the European Union with the euro, with the pound, or with the Scottish pound? And what significance would that have?
Cocab Stewart.
I thank you for that intervention. I will come back to some of those points, but my points about what we are missing out on, and remember, Scotland did not vote for Brexit. And as I was saying, the replacement of vastly inferior Turin schemes and the European project. Europe has an ideal that has been stolen from us by a governing Tory party that was tearing itself apart on EU membership, costing them two prime ministers, admittedly, but it cost the rest of us so much more. I'm sure colleagues on the side of EU membership will discuss some of the broken promises of Brexiteers, a word I cannot abide, presiding officer, as it attempts to heroise those who inflicted this dreadful mess upon us. The UK government's own Office for Budget Responsibility last year predicted that Brexit had caused long-run productivity to be 4% lower, both exports and imports to and from the EU to be 15% lower. But at least the UK can now forge its own trade deals with nations around the world, right? Unlike the trade agreement with Japan, signed by Liz Truss as International Trade Secretary in 2019, who boasted that one of its benefits is that it lifted tariffs on cheese products from the UK. What a triumph. We can now sell more cheese to a nation halfway around the world, whom 90% of the population is actually lactose intolerant. Presiding officer, there isn't a single tangible benefit of Brexit that those who perpetrate it can cite. It turned the UK into an insular state on the periphery of real influence. It denied our citizens a myriad of crucial rights and privileges, and it's made it harder for key industries such as agriculture and hospitality to employ seasonal workers, and all without the democratic consent of the four nations of the UK. Unlike the European Union, the United Kingdom is not a union of equal partners. Scotland voted as a whole by 62% to remain in the EU. But in some parts of my constituency, that figure was as high as 78%. And that's why I am glad that we are debating this today. Brexit and EU membership cannot be allowed to drop off the radar of public debate. The Scottish Government's paper, An Independent Scotland in the EU, is an informed prospectus of what we can aspire to be as a nation. With Labour now fully absorbing the Tory policy of staying out of the EU, along with the Liberal Democrats, it's clear that the only route back is an independent country. I am therefore encouraged that it is the Scottish Government's position that applying to become a member of the European Union would happen as soon as possible after achieving independence. And of course, there are certain criteria for joining. These would be subject to the individual negotiation once Scotland has become a candidate country. I think that when independent, the Scots could apply and probably get in pretty quickly through the door marked accession. Not my words, presiding officer, but those of Lord Kerr, former ambassador and now permanent representative to the European Union. I am mindful of time, presiding officer, so I will come to a close. Scotland's brightest days lie ahead of us. Independence in Europe is normal. Just look around. Small independent nations such as Denmark, Finland, Slovakia, Croatia, Ireland, similar population sizes to Scotland, are in a true union of equals with equal say and voting power in the Council of Europe as larger nations such as France and Germany. We deserve so much better, and I believe that the door is open for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Christine Graham. Mr Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have always believed, Presiding Officer, that it is a privilege to speak in this chamber. But I must confess that I am becoming frustrated by the government priorities and their failure to use this chamber to acknowledge and to address the massive challenges the people of Scotland are living through. Today, we could be debating how we're going to tackle the increasing waiting lists within our NHS, what the government is going to do to deal with the pressures social care is under, and the fact that it has kicked its unworkable National Care Service policy into the long grass. In Fife, we have ambulances lined up outside the hospital for hours on end, and we're not talking about this, or even indeed, we're not talking of how we're going to fix it. GPs are struggling under pressure. More are due to retire, and the NH Board in Fife tells me it does not have a plan. Indeed, they acknowledge they don't have any idea how many GPs are due to retire in the coming years. The answer they give is that GPs are private businesses. It's not good enough, and it requires the attention of this Parliament.
Minister Jeannie Hepburn.
I wonder if Mr Rowley would recognise, as many others do, that one of the significant pressures the National Health Service is facing right now is the inability to recruit from other parts of the world, including, for example, from the European Union.
Alec Rowley.
I certainly would acknowledge that the National Health Service is facing massive pressures, and part of that is to be able to recruit from abroad. But actually, the biggest reason is the failure of this government to workforce plan for our National Service. And it's high time this government actually accepted some responsibility, because we're not going to sort the problems in Scotland until we have a government that will accept their responsibility for doing so. So there is so much more we need to be addressing. How are we going to fix Scotland's failing public transport system? Or what are we doing to ensure further education can survive the latest round of budget cuts? Only last week, I asked the Education Secretary in this chamber to make government time available to discuss the crisis in our schools and what must be done to address the issues. But here we are today, another debate about building borders with England and fantasising about independence in Europe.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank Mr Rowley for giving way, Presiding Officer. Mr Rowley is a reasonable man, and a man who is always asking for increased funding for public services. I fall into the same category. Does Mr Rowley recognise that estimated £40 billion of lost tax receipts that have occurred because of Brexit have had a major impact on public service spending across these islands?
Alec Rowley.
I'm glad the Mr Stewart said across these islands, because I would acknowledge, but I would equally say to you that the waste that we have seen in Scotland, because we've not prioritised our public services, so we've not prioritised the powers that we have in this Parliament, that's part of the problem. But as long as we have a government that won't accept its responsibility for running public services in Scotland, then we can hardly make any progress. I believe, as I'm sure a large majority of this chamber agree, Brexit has been bad for the UK. But we are where we are, and we must face up to the reality of that situation and act in the best interests of the people of Scotland. I also believe this country would be in a better position now if it were not down to the disastrous attempts of successive Tory governments to negotiate the terms of that exit from the EU. But the UK voted by a majority to leave the EU and has spent a considerable amount of time negotiating the details, working to disentangle our economic, political and social system from the EU. I know the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee is about to do an inquiry into trade and cooperation agreements with the EU. So if the Scottish Government is serious about this issue, why not wait till the committee reports before we have such a debate? Now, I want to be clear. I fully support freedom of movement and have argued in the past for devolved migration powers to this Parliament. But I do not think that in itself will fix every problem Scotland faces. Indeed, far from it. In fact, I would go further and say that if people coming into this country will face the same problems that people living in this country are already facing, a massive shortage of affordable and social housing, ever-increasing waiting lists in our health care, a social care system buckling under the pressure of an ageing population, and a clueless government with no idea how to fix it. So instead of spending their time arguing about what could be, I will close my contribution in this debate by actually looking at what's on the table, what could actually improve the conditions across the UK in anything close to a reasonable timescale, a UK Labour government, to end the division that has come from Brexit, both within our country and with our closest neighbours. Labour will prioritise in government to improve relations with our closest neighbours, supporting businesses improving the Brexit deal to help trade investment, clean energy, including a new public energy company, GB Energy, being created and headquartered here in Scotland. It is for the SNP Green government to decide if it will make the most of what that new arrangements are in the best interests of the people of Scotland, or if they will continue to argue that until they have every power, they cannot make use of any power. Scotland deserves better than this SNP government.
Thank you, Mr Rowley. I call Christine Graham to be followed by Ivan McKee. Ms Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Alec Rowley for his Labour campaign message. And I say to him, we could do more for the NHS in Scotland and public services. And the same is true of England, where strikes prevail, incidentally, if the UK economy, which dictates our economy, was not in such a mess as even Sir Keir Starmer admits. But back to that Better Together mantra in the 2014 referendum campaign, which no doubt in my mind cost us that small percentage of votes to take us over the 50% hurdle to independence, namely that you can only guarantee Scotland's EU membership by staying in the UK. Well, what to do? Accept this mess, because someone, including Alec Rowley, would say, well, we are where we are. I'll come back to that. Let's start at the very beginning. It's a very good place to start. In 2016, Scotland voted overwhelmingly to remain in the EU by 62% to 38%. We can't say that often enough. Every single one of Scotland's 32 local authorities voted to reject Brexit. Can't say that often enough. So we were dragged out, and it was done in the middle of a pandemic. Brilliant timing. I say to Neil Bibby, the 1975 referendum campaign as to whether to join the European community, the SNP campaign, yes, it did campaign no, but crucially, in quotes, not on anyone else's terms. Well, we not only joined on someone else's terms and checked with Scotland's fishing community, we left in the same way. How sensible we were then to reject leave, because since then we've had food shortages, a fishing sellout, export crisis, workforce shortages, to name but a few. Scotland, like the rest of the UK, is now forced to pay the price of the Tories' damaging hard Brexit. What happened to the oven-ready meal? Promises made, and not in any particular order of merit, were Better Together campaign director Blair McDougall telling Scotland that Boris Johnson would never become Prime Minister. The biggest and most disputed claim put forward by the Leave camp was that Britain sends £350 million a week to the EU, and that money could be used instead to fund the NHS. The UK provides strength, stability and international clout. Move over Liz Truss, her tenure as Prime Minister, and the pound fell down to the lowest level ever recorded. Instead of the UK having surplus cash to use at its leisure, it has instead seen its economy shrink. The Centre for Economic Reform said in December that Brexit has left the UK economy 5.5% smaller than it would have been had it remained. Then, Donald Cameron, with pensions, vote no to protect your pension. The UK has the lowest pension out of all neighbouring countries, and at the bottom of the league in the developed world, according not to Christine Graham, but the OECD. Taking back control of our borders. Net migration has been unusually high in the past 2 years. The Office for National Statistics estimates that net migration to the UK was 745,000 in 2022, up from 184,000 in 2019 before the pandemic, and most migrants are legal and have increased. Meanwhile, Brexit has created a shortage of workers in the UK, certainly, I mentioned you in dispatches.
Alec Riley.
I thank Christine Graham for taking the intervention. Does Christine Graham not accept that we have a problem in Scotland where people are not coming to stay in Scotland, and that's partly down to the fact that we don't have the houses to house them in and the public services to offer them?
Christine
Graham. I don't like to say she's such a nice man. Stop shooting yourself in the foot. You know perfectly well that our capital budget is dictated by what Westminster divvies out to us. You know that. I beg your pardon. The member knows that as well as the rest of us. So you're too clever to pretend otherwise. But I know you've got to try and fight the corner for the Labour Party, no matter what. Anyway, we've got a shortage of workers, and the workers are in very important areas, and it's contributed significantly to it. Now, we come to levelling up. Broadly, that's money that used to come directly from the EU to Scotland for projects. It now comes from London, bypasses the Scottish Parliament, which has responsibility, for example, for infrastructure, straight to local authorities and so on, deliberately undermining devolution. No border down the Irish Sea. Well, there is. And while I welcome the probable return of power sharing in Northern Ireland, certainly for the good of the people, what is that £3.8 billion? An enticement or a bribe? Details are to follow. Cross-border England-Scotland. I say to Neil Bibby, look at the north of the North Sea to Sweden and Norway. Both countries are members of the Schengen area, and there are therefore no immigration controls. Sweden is part of the European Union and, crucially, the European Union Customs Union. And yes, there are customs checks between the two countries. These checks are performed by the Norwegian Customs and Excise Authorities and the Swedish Customs Service. They are sporadic along the Norway-Sweden border. Cars are not usually forced to stop, and to combat smuggling, the use of CCTV surveillance has been increased with systems using automatic number plate recognition. It works. It's not a problem. The reality is that Brexit has been an unmitigated disaster for the UK, let alone Scotland. But the scales have fallen from the eyes of many, deceived by false promises. And in Scotland, that threat in the 2014 referendum that we've thrown out if we voted yes. No wonder we are denied a referendum now. The sense of Brexit progress can be measured in the latest unheard study, which found UK-wide that 54% now feel it was the wrong decision, while less than 30% now mildly or strongly agree it was the right move. And if I have time, very briefly, DPO, it's to the amendments. Labour leader Sir Keir Starmer has ruled out rejoining the EU or the single market if his party comes to power. He has steadied the Labour ship by veering into soft Tory territory, as the managing director of Iceland, Richard Walker, let slip recently. Once he sought to be a Tory MP, he's now happy that Sir Keir Starmer has moved into central Tory territory. And the Tory amendment is pretty pathetic and tedious. It was a Tory government which, by a whisker of leave votes, UK-wide caused a constitutional earthquake. We're still suffering the aftershocks. As for the Lib Dem amendment, which reads at one point, line 6 of a very wordy amendment, typical of a Liberal amendment, quotes, "These essential steps to EU membership will help restore the economy, etc." So I'm pleased to see that their long-established skills at fence-sitting remain undiminished. Rejoin or not, who knows, do they? So I go back to the beginning. As you know, people often say when faced with the results of bad decisions, well, we are, Mr. Rowley, where we are. Now, if I was given a wrong turn and ended up facing a precipice, I would put the car into reverse gear in the blink of an eye. An independent Scotland will do just that and rejoin the EU.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I now call Ivan McKee to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Mr. McKee.
Thank you. They've turned John on. Oh, turn me on now. Good. Thank you very much. Thank you, President Officer. It's a pleasure to speak in this debate. I'm just noticing, and maybe I'm not correct here, but I think 4 of the last 5 speakers have been SNP backbenchers, and I don't know if that's because the opposition parties aren't taking up their speaking slots in this debate. I'd be interested to have a look at that later. But that kind of talks to my first point, very pertinently, because it's unusual in a democracy to have an issue where there's a clear majority in favour of a particular course of action, but almost all parties are opposed to taking that course of action, particularly in Scotland, but absolutely across the rest of the UK now as well. As Christine Graham has now identified, there's a very clear majority in favour of rejoining the European Union. And it's unusual to have that on such an important issue as we have before us today, because despite the efforts of some on the opposition benches to talk down this issue, it's hugely critical to Scotland's economy and to much else besides. We can understand the Tories, because they're running scared of Nigel Farage, who's playing cat and mouse with them, and they're absolutely petrified of what Reform, or whatever party is running just now, is going to do to them at the forthcoming election. We've got Labour running scared of red wall voters in Tory seats, and as a consequence, sitting on the fence on this, as in much else, in Keir Starmer's lack of manifesto for what a Labour government, and lack of principled positions from Labour on what they would do if they won the next election. And then we've got the Lib Dems, scared of blue wall voters in Tory seats, abandoned their pro-EU position, and even their motion can't bring itself to argue for rejoin. It's only the SNP that are unambiguously in favour of rejoining the EU, recognising the importance that could deliver to Scotland's economy and society, and reflecting the clear, very clear position of the vast majority of Scottish voters. The reality of the hard Brexit we've ended up with, no free movement, no single market, no customs union, and the economic impact that's had has been mentioned on growth, on tax revenues, access to market, that European market for business. Donald Cameron, I can't remember, I think Donald Cameron was in favour of Remain back in 2016, because I think he's a more reasonable chap than some of his colleagues. Maybe he's going to correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's where he was. But I don't know on what planet he is where he can stand up and talk about rural depopulation and not recognise the link between that and Brexit, where he can stand up and talk about the virtues of the Windsor Agreement, but not ask the question, why is that good for Northern Ireland, but not good for Scotland to have the ability to be part of the European market. And we've got Neil Bibby for Labour stands up and fails to recognise the damage done by Brexit to our economy, to our tax base, and as a consequence to our public sector funding. And talking about labour shortages without recognising the impact that Brexit has had on the ability of people to come and live and work and share their skills in Scotland. Because Labour policy on the EU, talking about the aspirations that they have to forge those closer links, but own recognition of how that would come about, of why the EU would give those benefits to a third country without very significant negotiations. But the only way to secure that is to be a full member of the European Union. And this tired old nonsense about some experts have said at some point that we'd need to join the Euro, clearly debunked misinformation being spread by the Labour front bench. And the third of the Brexit boys, I'm not going to leave you out, Willie Rennie, the opportunities are all about trying to make small steps to remove barriers that rejoining would solve in one step. So why isn't rejoin mentioned explicitly and clearly in the Lib Dem amendment, and why have they deleted the calls to rejoin unambiguously the EU that are in the SNP motion? So the failure to deliver the benefits of Brexit, some colleagues have talked about trade deals, no US trade deal, of course, Canada trade deal been falling down because of a disagreement over cheese. Meanwhile, the EU, of course, has been mentioned, has the CETA deal with Canada, and the New Zealand and Australia deals badly negotiated and going to cause significant problems for Scottish agriculture. And even on that benefit, alleged benefit, in Tory eyes of restricting immigration, of course, we recognise that's a hugely damaging step. But even on their own argument about Brexit leading towards reduced immigration, that is the issue that's still ripping the Tory party apart, that obsession with stopping people coming to these shores. And don't forget, as Christine Graham has mentioned, we should never forget what we were told during the 2014 referendum, that voting no to independence would guarantee EU membership. How ridiculous that position looks now. So the other point I think has been made very well by the government front bench and is in the motion, that Brexit process clearly showed Westminster's contempt for the view of the wishes of Scottish voters and their complete unwillingness to negotiate or entertain any separate deal for Scotland vis-à-vis the EU, as has been agreed for with Northern Ireland. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, our unashamed vision clearly articulated in the government's paper and by the Cabinet Secretary in his comments today is of an independent future in the EU. It reflects our values, very different from the values of the Tory party. In fact, nobody knows where Labour's values are these days. It enables free movement, it enables vast economic opportunity. Scotland is a part of the European family of nations, like other small, successful European countries. And it's very important that we keep this agenda, this item on the agenda, keep reminding voters in Scotland of why we have the damage in Brexit, the damage it is causing to an economy and society, the fact that rejoining is overwhelmingly popular, that the SNP is the only party that's offering that, and we take that message forward to the voters of Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Karen Adam. Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have to say that I'm once again baffled. We've been brought to this chamber to debate a topic that we have no jurisdiction over, and this time about an organisation that we're not even a member of. We have seen before our eyes the dying days of a nationalist government. They are losing the argument about the breaking up of the United Kingdom, and they know it. Their dreadful record of failure and secrecy is being exposed day by day, and they have no fresh ideas on failures that they have created. Therefore, they have decided to waste all our time by spending an entire afternoon of chamber business on an exercise that will have no positive impact on the people of Scotland. And Deputy Presiding Officer, come the end of this Parliament, in 2.5 years' time, I am sure that we'll begin to hear a number of excuses about how the SNP have run out of time to deliver legislation and yet again broken promises to the Scottish people. But the truth is that they are content to waste all the time in the world discussing their own constitutional obsession instead of people's priorities. Because, Presiding Officer, one second, because, Presiding Officer, the SNP like to throw around accusations of democracy denier, but it's actually they who are in denial. Yeah. They have decided that the results of two referendums in 2014 and 2016 are too inconvenient for the narrative that they are trying to spin. Instead, they stick their heads in the sand, insisting that the public somehow were duped.
Emma Harper.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you taking an intervention. I'm a substitute on Rural Committee. Would you not agree that the convener of that committee, who happens to be on the Conservative benches, he's actually tried to delay the bills and passing of legislation in this place, and you're actually blaming the Scottish Government?
We need to speak through the chair, Jeremy Balfour.
I think what he's trying to do is scrutinise this out-of-touch Scottish Government, which is bringing forward proposals and hate any form of scrutiny. The truth is that the majority of people made the assessment that we are better off as a member of the United Kingdom. Then 2 years later, a majority of people in the United Kingdom made the decision that they would no longer be a member of the European Union. That's it. It's really that simple. We do not need to rehash this over and over again. The SNP must accept that rejoining the European Union is nowhere near the top of people's list of priorities. Most people do not care about constitutional grievance. They care about high-quality public services. They care about the children's standard of education. They care about having access to the NHS. Of all these topics would be far more better debated, but they won't be because they don't like scrutiny.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank Jeremy Balfour for taking the intervention and for taking the trouble to be brought to the Chamber this afternoon to do his job? But can I ask, if he's concerned about public services, is he aware of the £40 billion mentioned by Kevin Stewart as having been loaded on to make up for the Brexit deficit, and the additional information today that £2 billion will be added to council taxpayers' bills in England? That's the cost of Brexit, and that's why we can't improve public services to the extent we'd like to, isn't it?
Jeremy Balfour.
Perhaps before I enter, I should point out to the member who may not know that I've actually been in hospital for 10 weeks and in those 10 weeks did not miss one vote. So I ask him to withdraw the statement that he made about being dragged to this chamber. They would also be far more worthy of investment in what the public want them to do. People do not understand what is going on. I'd be interested to know how much money they have spent on this independence movement. How many more nurses, carers or teachers could have been paid with the money that has instead been decided on this paper? Let me just finish this point. How much, Cabinet Secretary, has been wasted so there is no eye pavilion in your constituency left here in the capital?
Just for clarity, I've been able to put this on the record. The sum total of what we've spent on the production of these papers thus far represents 0.00025% of the Scottish Government budget. So not quite as much as I think is being thought by the member, and an awful lot less than was wasted in the morass of Michelle Moan procuring PPE equipment for hundreds of millions of pounds spent by the UK Government.
Jeremy Balfour.
I look forward to when I bring forward my disability commissioner and I'm told it's too expensive and it's less than that figure, that he will come back and tell me that that is not a good use of money. Presiding officer, this is not a serious debate. If it was, the SNP would be able to answer the most basic questions, like how long would it take to rejoin the EU? What currency would they suggest we use? And what other border situation would be? It's in there, but it is fantasy, Minister. It is fantasy. We have no honest answer because they know the answer is ridiculous. It's an absurd proposition, for example, to abandon a strong currency such as a pound and shack ourselves to the euro. But that's what they would do if we joined the EU. It's ridiculous to suggest that we put ourselves through that one. And as one SNP advised, he would describe Brexit 10 times over. Yeah. I would encourage this government to reconsider wasting Scottish people's time and money on vanity projects. Instead, get on with the day job, deliver what people's priorities are, and if you can't, move over and let us do it instead.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Bill Kidd. Mr Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I have to say it's not often I'm agreeing with my colleague Jeremy Balfour there, but I do agree with the statement that we are in the last days of a dying nationalist government, and it's the one in Westminster. This debate marks the publication of the 7th paper in the series of the Scottish Government's Building a New Scotland series. But the first paper in the series set out a detailed analysis of the UK's performance across a range of economic and social indicators relative to that of 10 European countries, including Norway and Denmark, the former being a member of EFTA and the latter being a full member of the EU. The analysis put forward in that first paper comparing the economic and social performance of the UK, and therefore Scotland within it, to 10 comparator countries suggests overwhelmingly that independent countries of Scotland's size do better. This is particularly true of independent countries of Scotland's size within the internal market, be that via EFTA or as a full member of the European Union. Presiding officer, I stood atop the picturesque cliff top at Roseharty in my constituency last summer, and I looked out across the North Sea. And aside from the spectacular coastal scenery, these rocks are the closest point of our mainland to Norway. And if you were to look at the 16th century map, the Carta Marina, you would be forgiven for thinking Scotland was just a stone's throw away from both Norway and Denmark.
And while the first map of the Nordic countries to give details and place names greatly exaggerates our proximity, our relative closeness both in geography and culture has meant that for many centuries, the commercial and social connections between Scotland and the rest of Europe, particularly its northern reaches, have gone from strength to strength. And it came as a surprise really to no one, therefore, that Scotland voted nearly 2-1 to remain in the European Union. Scotland is European, I've said it before and I'll say it again, and I will continue to say it for as long as I have the privilege to be a representative in Scotland's National Parliament, because the democratic will of Scotland will not be ignored. This might be an inconvenient detail for the Unionists, but remaining within the European Union is the clear will of the Scottish people. And Scots now find our membership of the internal market, our freedom of movement, and the social, cultural and economic benefits which came with it, stolen from us. Stolen from us, Presiding Officer, by a UK government and an indifferent Westminster opposition who delivered us the hardest of Brexits on a vote won by the narrowest of margins south of the border and based on so many lies. Lies about taking back control, of a Britain bursting at the seams, and the most egregious one affecting the coastal communities who put their faith in the UK government to deliver for them a sea of opportunity. Speaking with fisheries stakeholders recently, I was given numerous examples of seafood processing businesses still suffering the consequences of this denial of Scottish democracy. More than 7.5 years on from the vote, some of those businesses are composed of up to 90% migrant workers. And our loss of freedom of movement, coupled with hostile immigration policies, is threatening Scotland's flagship industries. We've all heard the stories of shellfish rotting on the way to the European markets because of the new UK government red tape. But it's not only fisheries that have been let down. Our farmers have been undercut by the few trade deals the UK government has managed to negotiate. We couldn't export our seed potatoes, and our soft fruits were rotten on the vine each harvest without the adequate numbers of seasonal workers to pick them. All of us have heard of the woes of the hospitality sector with staffing shortages. Mm-hmm. And I've had meetings in my constituency with hoteliers. And, Presiding Officer, the lack of chefs, for example, has been extraordinarily detrimental to local services. Perhaps the saddest of all is the impact Brexit will have on the futures of Scotland's children. These last couple of weeks, some of my children have been preparing their university applications, and this has caused me to reflect upon the opportunities that they may have in years to come. With the UK government's refusal to negotiate membership of the Erasmus Plus programme, Westminster has deprived so many young Scots of the opportunity to live and learn, exchange across the continent. And I urge the Scottish Government to do all it can to restore Scotland's membership of this cross-border educational, social and cultural initiative, which does so much to build friendships across borders and maintain lasting peace in Europe. Independence offers Scotland the opportunity to rejoin the European Union and regain all that we've lost. Scotland's history is interwoven with the histories of our European neighbours, and Scotland's present is as European as our past. And Scotland's future, Presiding Officer, is as an independent state in the European Union. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. And the last speaker in the open debate will be Bill Kidd. Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The last speaker in the opening debate, and the sun is still blazing down outside, possibly because it knows that I'm getting up to speak. Anyway, thank you. Somebody laugh at least. Thank you. Anyway, thank you, Presiding Officer. So, listening to today's arguments, it's clear to me that the benefits of being part of the EU far outweigh those of not being a member. In the Scottish Government's accompanying document to its Building a New Scotland, an Independent Scotland in the EU paper on why EU membership matters, a number of benefits are listed. And although these points have been touched upon throughout today's debate, I feel it's important just to reiterate some of them to recognise the practical day one benefits to ordinary Scots of EU membership. So please let's recognise the facts that as a Scottish citizen and an EU citizen, you would have the right to live, visit, study and work freely in any EU member state without burdensome paperwork. You would have the right to equal access to healthcare if you fall sick or have an accident while travelling in the EU. You would also be able to use your driving licence throughout the EU. You would have more job choices, with your professional qualifications being recognised throughout the EU. You would also have the right to establish your business in any EU member state. Your rights would be protected by EU law, benefiting from guaranteed minimum working conditions and protected social security rights. And you'd be able to boost your career opportunities and improve your language skills through access to the Erasmus Plus programme. And thanks to being a member of the world's largest single market, you would enjoy more product choice at the supermarket for the best prices. And in answer to points over the effect of the current UK arrangements, let's also recognise the facts that you would continue to be able to move freely between Scotland, the rest of the UK and Ireland with no new passport or immigration checks through the common travel area. You would also continue to have the right to live, work and access services, including housing, education and healthcare in the UK and Ireland under the common travel area. These are facts, not conjure or hope, not conjecture, but simply plain facts, facts that need to be recognised by all parties across this chamber, regardless of our personal views, if we are to have an informed and honest debate about the issue. If we are to be honest with the people of Scotland, we need to be clear in our position regarding EU membership, regardless of our position on Scottish independence. For whilst I believe that independence offers the best route towards EU membership alongside a continued positive relationship with the rest of the UK, for those against independence, I do not believe this precludes them from supporting EU membership. And I would ask all of us to be honest with ourselves and honest with the people of Scotland over the undeniable benefits of EU membership. We've heard today of the benefits of EU membership for ordinary Scots, and the benefit to our economy and businesses are equally undeniable. As an EU member state, we'd be able to be part of the world's largest single market, with almost 450 million consumers compared to the UK's 65 million. Scottish businesses need to be able to sell more to more customers and trade more freely with other businesses. Checks on goods between Scotland and the EU would be removed, and measures would be put in place to smooth checks required as a result of Brexit on goods moving to and from England and Wales. EU membership would be making trading cheaper and quicker, and would be an important factor in attracting foreign investment to Scotland. Scotland would be able to draw people from across the EU to work in our businesses, study at our universities and contribute to our public services. People living in Scotland would be able to offer their services throughout the EU, and Scotland would have the opportunity to influence future EU regulations and standards in ways that reflects the interests of Scottish businesses. Online selling would be easier and safer, with better protection for businesses. Scotland would have the same opportunities as other member states to access EU funding, such as support for agriculture, infrastructure, regional economic development, and guaranteed participation in programmes such as Horizon Europe, which supports research and innovation. So, conclusion, Presiding Officer, I believe it's clear that if we are to be true to the pledge that got us elected and that is to best serve the interests of our constituents and of Scotland, we need to support EU membership. And to be honest, Presiding Officer, the way to do that, having listened to the other political parties in here, is through independence. I support today's motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. We now move to the wind-up speeches. I call first Willie Rennie, around 6 minutes. Mr. Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a bit of a soporific debate. The only element of excitement was when Ivan McKee was talking about John Mason being turned on during the debate. I suspect he was talking about the microphone rather than anything else, but nevertheless, it was a dangerous double entendre. But that was the only excitement from the whole debate, I would argue, because in reality, this is more about independence. Let me finish my point in a second. This is more about independence than it is about the European Union. And the SNP are desperate to shore up their support across the country, which is leaking away very fast. And it will be a deep concern to them, which is why they're scrapping around, trying to find issues to shore up the support for the party. I'll take an intervention.
Well, first of all, Mr Rennie, I affirm your contribution, exciting and riveting. But I would also, so you shouldn't really have stopped me from intervening, I'm going to compliment you, but could you please explain to me whether or not the Liberal Democrats are, at some time, at some point in the future, in favour of rejoining the EU?
Through the chair, Ms Graham, Willie Rennie.
It's not a secret. We are a pro-European party and we'd love to be a member of the European Union. What we are dealing with, and this is where the SNP failed to strike reality, is that people today are worried about how they're going to pay for their energy bills. They are worried about how they're going to house themselves. They're overcrowded. I have lots of people in North East Fife who are desperate for a home. These are the issues that people are facing now. Not some esoteric debate about potentially joining the European Union at some point. Of course, we've got to improve the economic conditions for the country, which is why my gradualist approach of making sure we break down the trade barriers so it's easier for people to trade across Europe in a much easier... Could you let me finish my point, please? Thank you. So to make sure that we trade as easily as possible across the European Union to help people in their jobs here in Scotland. That's, I think, the sensible approach that people in this country are desperate for politicians to address, rather than some remote debate, which is a proxy for a debate about independence. Yes, we'll take an intervention.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I wonder if Mr Rennie's looked at the motion that we've lodged, though. There's nothing within our motion that's inconsistent with him taking and articulating the approach that he has laid out. His so-called gradualist approach could be easily accommodated within a simple, straightforward declaration that Scotland's place would be best served by being part of the EU. Why is he not supporting that?
Willie Rennie.
I don't support the SNP's approach to this because, really, this is about trying to secure independence and using Europe in order to secure that. But what was curious about this debate is there was a conflict between different members of the SNP. Some, like Claire Adamson, said, let's not talk about the past. From the party that celebrates Bannockburn and argues over the Stone of Destiny fragments, whether they're in Alex Salmond's house or in SNP HQ. It's curious. But then Kevin Stewart went on to start reading out lyrics from the Corries before Karen Adam started talking about the ancient connections with Norway. Now, if we are going to be serious about this and deal with those constituents and their concerns that I am deeply concerned about in their energy bills and their housing, then we need to just be rid of this pointless debate about the... Can I finish the point, please? So, about this pointless debate on independence, which the SNP lost in 2014 and just simply can't accept. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Kevin Stewart.
Presiding officer, I recognise, like Mr Rennie, that my constituents, like his, have got many problems that they are facing at this moment. Some of those problems have been exacerbated by Brexit. And one example is a shortage of medicines at this moment in time. And of course, Britain actually hosted the European Medicines Agency, which has now gone elsewhere. And Europe intends to bolster the supply of medicines, which puts medicine supplies here at risk. Does he not think it would be a good idea to join the European Union and rejoin the European Medicines Agency?
Willie Rennie, I can give you time back for the interventions.
Of course, I would love to have pragmatic solutions to these medicine problems. Of course I would like that. But Kevin Stewart needs to face reality that we lost the argument. We lost the argument on Europe, and we need to find pragmatic ways of moving that forward. But the other thing that the SNP didn't talk about in this is the currency. And Maurice Golden was bang on with this. Because when he says, he described their... I'm trying to develop the point that Maurice Golden, I thought, eloquently made in his contribution. He said that the policy, in the meantime, would be for an independent Scotland to keep the UK pound, the British pound. Then they would move towards its own currency. That would take some years, some say up to 10 years. But we know that it would be impossible for any country to join the European Union if it had adopted the currency of another country if it was outside the European Union. So potentially we have that 10-year period where Scotland is developing its own currency, where we are both independent and outside the European Union. Now, we know that it's been deeply damaging to be outside the European Union. We know it would be deeply damaging to be outside the United Kingdom, but to be outside of both is super isolation. And I thought Maurice Golden explained that incredibly well. And not unsurprisingly, none of the SNP benches talked about it. Now, I wonder why that was, is because there is a gaping hole in their policy. The other issue that they did not talk about was the immigration issue, not just now, was the immigration issue. Now, they did say there was negative impacts from Brexit on immigration, and I accept that. I agree with that wholeheartedly. But they didn't say why Scotland seemed to be incapable of attracting even a fraction of the net 700,000 immigration to the UK. Now, if we are an incredibly attractive place, as the SNP say that we are, surely they would be flooding over the Scottish-English border, but they're not. So what hope would we have that an independent Scotland would be able to attract all these hordes of people that were desperate, we say were desperate, to attract to the country? Another issue that the SNP just simply did not address. They only pick the issues that advance their argument, not for the EU, but for independence. But the main thing, and this comes back to Alex Rowley's, I thought, very powerful point, where he said, you get the feeling that the SNP are not prepared to use any of their powers until they've got all of their powers, sacrificing people in the process in order to make their case for independence. I don't think that's in Scotland's interest. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. I now call Faisal Chowdhury. Around 7 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the past few months, we have seen countless debate on the SNP's ideological pipe dream of independence and valuable taxpayers' money being spent on this white paper outlining this fantasy scenario. This vital time in the chamber could have been used to address the many people in Scotland still struggling with the cost of living crisis. We could be discussing the vast array of health and social inequalities still present in Scotland, or addressing the serious problem with NHS and mental health support waiting times. Instead, we are here once again to talk about independence. The SNP are doing down on politics of division in a desperate attempt to distract from the real problems facing people in Scotland. As Maurice Golden and Neil Beebe outlined, the SNP are wasting money working on myths and fantasy. Instead of hypothetical papers outlining a series of ifs, when and maybes, the Scottish Government could be implementing politics right now that can minimise the damage caused by Brexit. Willie Rennie highlighted that the UK's withdrawal from the Erasmus programme meant the loss of opportunities for thousands of Scottish students to travel and study abroad. This opportunity was also lost to thousands of international students who would have wanted to visit and study in Scotland. If the Scottish Government are serious in their ambition to build a more vibrant, visible and connected Scottish community around the world, then they must replace the Erasmus scheme. In order to maintain good relations with the EU, the Scottish Government must commit to renewing an international student exchange programme. The Welsh Labour... let me progress. I'll come to you in a minute. I've got a lot to go through. The Welsh Labour Government have already implemented the TAFE scheme to replace Erasmus with funding of £65 million over 5 years. There will be an estimated 15,000 participants from Wales by the end of August 2026. The Scottish Government must implement an international educational exchange programme now to ensure Scotland stay visible and connected in terms of education. Claire.
Cabinet Secretary.
The best answer to being outside the Erasmus Plus scheme is to be back in it.
Is the position of the Scottish Labour Party, or indeed the UK Labour Party, that like Horizon, it's in favour of rejoining Erasmus Plus? Again, it's quite simple, it's a yes or a no.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I find it very difficult to understand our Cabinet Secretary or ministers. I mean, obviously, the SNP had, you know, I mean, we are out of Brexit. I mean, we're out of Europe now. So why are we talking about the past when a lot of colleagues have mentioned that let's move forward? Why don't we, if they can do it in Wales, why can we not do it in Scotland? Why are we just talking about what we have done and how? Why should we not move forward? Claire Adamson outlined that the Brexit disaster has isolated the UK from the benefits of EU members are receiving as part of the customs union. By the Scottish Government's own admission, an independent Scotland joining the EU would take years of complex negotiation and deals. Not to mention the chaos that would ensue from trying to separate Scotland from the place with which it shares a border, a currency, countless institutions, and an internal market. If Brexit has taught us anything, it is that withdrawing from an economic political union is shrouded in difficulty and regret. Neil Beebe highlighted the mess that the Tories have made over Brexit. They created division and difficult relationship with our European allies and economic partners and created a sea of chaos for business seeking to maintain trade and business in Europe. But as has already been said in this chamber many times, independence is not the solution to the Brexit chaos. Presiding officer, Labour want to make Brexit work. Revisiting old roads will only create more division, distractions from the real and immediate problem facing people in Scotland. We would seek to end divisions between the UK and the EU to Brexit and rest of our relations in Europe. Labour's priority in government will be to improve our relationship with our closest neighbours to help businesses and working people in Scotland across Britain. We would review and tear down unnecessary trade barriers and seek a new defence and security pact with the EU. I've got a lot to go through. A lot of SNP speakers had their chances. Let us have our chance to bring our points across as well, please. Kevin Stewart spoke about the doors that have been closed for Scottish businesses in terms of trade because of Brexit. In 2025, there is a scheduled review in the trade and cooperation agreement. The UK and the Scottish Government should be working together to take these opportunities to fix mistakes in Brexit process. This is the serious work that Scottish Government could be doing to mend broken relationship with our EU counterparts. Alex Rowley highlighted that the Scottish Government should be looking at it actually could do now to improve conditions in Scotland. Instead, continue fantasy of the ideological pipe dream of independence does nothing to help the people of Scotland. The people of Scotland deserve better, and Labour are prepared to pave the way to make this happen. Finally, presiding officer, Kevin Stewart spoke of the Balkan. I'm bringing your points up. So Kevin Stewart spoke of the Balkan states throwing off their imperial rulers. Are the SNP still trying to compare Scotland's union with the UK to an imperial colony? This is insulting to all those countries who fought hard for independence from Scotland as part of the United Kingdom. The SNP need to focus on what the people of Scotland desperately need, instead of doubling down on useless argument for independence. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Alexander Stewart, around 8 minutes. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to close the debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I will be supporting the amendment in the name of Donald Cameron. The issue of Scotland's relationship in Europe is indeed an important one, and it is a topic worthy of time within this chamber, Presiding Officer. Unfortunately, however, today's debate has focused on some of the old constitutional arguments we've heard repeated since 2016. We may well be in a new year, Presiding Officer, but this SNP government's assertion and addiction with the grievances fuel policies and grandstanding about the Constitution is and continues to become an old story. The SNP's latest independence wish list, titled An Independent Scotland in the EU, follows the same pattern that all the previous independent papers have seen since 2022. This means that it is happy to make bold claims about the future of independent Scotland, but even happier to sweep aside any of the potential problems that may arise from that under the carpet. A common theme throughout the Scottish Government's paper is that it is somehow inherently undemocratic when the wishes of Scotland differ from the wishes of the United Kingdom as a whole. The paper states that Scotland is a devolved nation within the United Kingdom. It does not have a seat at the table or a voice in the debate. Not only does it ignore the fact that Scotland sends 59 MPs to the House of Commons, it also has mistakes the belief that it having a seat at the table is a political union, which means they will always agree with one another. Political neighbours very rarely agree with one another, Presiding Officer. The truth is that all political unions involve a certain amount of give and take, and this would be no different for an independent Scotland in the European Union. As Spice has pointed out in the very analysis of this SNP paper, even through an independent Scotland, we'd have some small influence in the EU Council. Spice highlights that it is not necessarily the case that it will always achieve the outcome that Scotland wishes, and Scotland may often have to compromise to achieve an EU position. Happy to take intervention.
Minister.
Just in terms of talking of the equivalence, with the supposed equivalence of the two unions, he mentions that we send 59 MPs to Westminster, soon to be reduced to 57. That is, of course, out of a number of 650 before we get to over 800 unelected members of that legislature. He is right, of course, to refer to the occasions that neighbours, political neighbours, will not often agree with one another. But would he not recognise that the set of arrangements that exist in the European Union is that they are truly equal partners because they are full member states of the European Union, unlike the sub-state entity that Scotland is as part of the United Kingdom?
Alexander Stewart, I'll give you the time back.
I thank the Minister. You know, the Minister makes a point, but the best union we've had is the union of the United Kingdom. Yep. The strength that has accrued over generations in the possibilities that have been made is very much the case. It is hardly surprising, Presiding Officer, that the SNP condemns this kind of political give and take, because they don't want to see give and take. They want to ensure that they have and continue to have the concerns that they've raised. And they've made many points today, but they've made these points many, many, many times before. We see a similar doubling down from the SNP paper when it comes to issues like trade, Presiding Officer. An independent Scotland in the EU is keen to talk about opportunities of rejoining the single market. However, it's very little is said about the risks of leaving the UK's internal market. We've already heard and we know that Scotland's exports to the rest of the UK are worth three times more than the exports to the entire EU. Given this, it's hardly surprising that research by the Centre for Economic Performance at the London School of Economics found that trade disruption within the rest of the UK could result in a reduction from the Scottish income per capita of at least 6.3%. Happy to take an intervention.
Fergus Ewing.
Thank Mr. Stewart for giving way. I mean, he said that it was questionable what influence we had in the EU. Well, to give one example, between 1979 and 2020, the Highlands and Islands received over £1 billion, £1,024 million, my understanding. My late mother was influential in obtaining some of that under Objective 1. Surely that is a very good example of us having a positive voice in Europe, even although numerically we were not strong. And will the Conservatives, as a gesture of goodwill, following the £2.5 billion sweetener to Northern Ireland, put in a couple of billion so that we can get on with dueling the A9 and A96 even more quickly?
Alexander Stewart, I'll give you the time back.
I acknowledge and thank the member for his intervention, and I would also like to acknowledge the contribution the member's late mother did make in her time. That is well documented and should be recognised. And yes, he makes a very valid point, but if this government was managing to, for example, duel the A9, we wouldn't have to depend on funding coming from other places. Given that it's hardly, as I say, it's hardly surprising that we find ourselves in this position, and even Scotland were to rejoin the European Union straight away, this would have certain issues and certain timescales. We've already heard today about some of the problems that may arise. Spice also talks about the lack of answers on many issues, presiding officer. The paper doesn't really go into address relation or the volume of trade that currently happens. The SNP are happy to celebrate benefits of free trade when it doesn't involve other parts of the UK, just as the previous independence paper talked about. The Scottish Government simply shrugs its shoulders and confronts more serious issues when it comes to independence. Now, today we've heard lots of comments, and I'd like to spend a little bit of time, if I can, on that. But I also wish to note, Presiding Officer, that we don't seem to have any members from the Green Party with us today in the chamber or making a contribution. That's just something I note. Donald Cameron spoke about a third of the SNP voting for Brexit themselves. And 1 million people in Scotland voted for Brexit. And they talked about how the chained processes would take place in Brussels. Now, we should be talking today. We should be talking today about the priorities that face many people in Scotland today, and that's health, education and law and order. These are all documented, and we should be, as I say, spending time addressing some of the issues that should be done by the Scottish Government. But we've talked and we've heard today about failing targets. Now, we already know our housing targets have failed. We've already know that the A9 dueling has failed, and we already know that its time is being focused on things that are not relevant to people. But the priorities of Scotland and its population are vitally important and vitally important. But it's not. What we seem to have today is the focus on the fantasy politics. And Neil Bibby talked about that when he said that there were real fantasies that were being done on a day-to-day basis. Debates today are old debates. They're not discussing the things that we should be discussing. They're not looking at the way forward. They're not looking at the possibilities what's happening in Scotland. They're looking at a constitutional division. Willie Rennie talked about the two forms of nationalism. And I think that was a very valid point to make. And talking about the wrangling that goes on and the difficulties that take place. My time is tight, so I think I'm coming towards my conclusion. Maurice Golden talked about the currency issues, and they were vast about where we would be in this whole process. He talked about the failures within it, the fantasy, the money that's being wasted, the way that things are working, and people are not working for the people of Scotland. Jeremy Balfour touched on the idea that the SNP have been in government and continues to be in government, and that they are not looking at the priorities, and waste of time, and waste of the paper and the policies and the funding that's taking place to deal with all of this, Presiding Officer. So, to conclude, it's quite clear that at the beginning of my speech I talked about the relationship with Europe and how that is vitally important. And as the worth of the historical understandings we have within Europe and across different levels. But despite the Scottish Government would have us believe that Scotland can continue to have a strong relationship, and we need to have a strong relationship within Europe. But that's not going to be helped by becoming independent. Yeah. It will happen if we continually explore and look at what we can achieve rather than manufacturing grievance. The UK Government and the Scottish Government, people want us to work together to maintain a strong relationship in Europe, and more importantly, that will help the whole United Kingdom and work together. I look forward to hearing more things in the future, because I have no doubt, Presiding Officer, there will be many more debates of this nature, but I support the amendment in the name of Donald Cameron today.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. I now call on Jamie Hepburn to wind up the debate. Minister, a very generous 10 minutes or so.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking those members who have taken the time to contribute to the debate. I am somewhat disappointed, though, that there hasn't been a bit more engagement from those benches who are ranged against the motion that we've laid today. That might seem an unusual thing to say, but I welcome a debate about Scotland's future. And I would have hoped that we would have had more participation. Mr Kidd, wherever he might be, there he is, suggested that the reason when he was speaking the sun was still shining was to welcome him to the debate, but in fact it's because we saw a lack of participation from certain quarters to engage in the debate today, and I think that's a matter of regret, and hopefully more will debate when we return to this issue again in future. And of course I'll give way.
Neil Bibby.
The only party that doesn't seem to be represented in this chamber is the Scottish Greens. Is that who's been critical?
Minister.
Well, of course, I'm not a member of the Scottish Green Party, but ordinarily, Mr Bibby, you and members are lined up to take part in debates in this place. Where are they today? A meagre contribution from Mr Bibby's party. Let's talk about the purpose of today's debate. The background, of course, is, as the Cabinet Secretary laid out at the beginning of the debate, that we are approaching the anniversary of the withdrawal of the UK from the European Union. It seems entirely appropriate then that we debate this issue at that juncture. It's also entirely appropriate that we debate this issue when we consider the harm that has been wrought to the UK economy, the Scottish economy, as a consequence of Brexit. We see, and it was mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary, the 2.5% reduction to the UK economy. We've seen the OBR saying that they forecast in the long run a 4% reduction to UK GDP as a consequence of Brexit. We know that there's been social harms. We know that there's been damage to our businesses and to our public services as a consequence of Brexit. And the other purpose, of course, is to bring our ban series into this place to be debated. It's entirely legitimate. If we're going to undertake this work, as we have a mandate to do, and I'll come to that in a minute when I come to Mr Cameron's amendment. If we're going to take forward this work, then I will bring it to this chamber to be debated, because I think it's the right thing to do. Parliament should have the chance to engage with this material, and I hope to see more of that in the future. But the other opportunity, and we've deliberately worded our motion as we have to provide everyone this opportunity, was the chance for Parliament to come together to do as we have done before, to reassert our perspective that Scotland is best served by being part of the European Union. We have voted in favour of that proposition several times, and we've worded the motion deliberately, purposely, to enable people to do so. Yep. The Scottish Government's perspective is, of course, that independence is the route and the means by which we can re-engage with and become part of the European Union again. I recognise that others do not agree with that perspective. That's why I intervened early on Mr Cameron. He seemed a little surprised I did that, and he dismissed it a little by suggesting somewhat facetiously, I think, that my intervention was important. It was an important intervention because he suggested that the title of this debate was an independent Scotland in the EU. The debate is not styled as that. It's about Scotland's place in the EU. And for all those who supposedly say that they believe that Scotland would be best served by being part of the European Union, they still have the opportunity to vote in favour of the motion we've laid to back that proposition. Let me turn to the amendments that have been laid by other colleagues. The first from the Tories. I have to say they deride our motion for being predictable. Well, I'm afraid to say the Tory amendment was entirely predictable. It seems to be necessary once again to remind the Conservative benches that it is entirely proper and appropriate that the Scottish Government takes forward the activity that we are undertaking. Why is it appropriate? Why is it legitimate for us to undertake this activity? Well, we stood on a platform of saying we would undertake this activity. We actually derived a mandate from the people of Scotland to undertake this activity. Yes. So they can complain as much as they want. We're going to keep taking forward this activity and bring it back to this place to be debated. And incidentally, as an aside, I have to say to Jeremy Balfour, who suggested that this debate would somehow push our legislative agenda off the table, we'd take that rather more seriously if we didn't see the Conservative convener of the Rural Affairs Committee unilaterally, without recourse to the committee, determining that that committee would not meet to consider Stage 2 of the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill on his own, without recourse to the wider committee, which will cause a delay to that legislation. And I have to say, the suggestion that the cancellation of a committee meeting as a means by which the government can be held to account is a new one on me, Mr Balfour. Yeah. And of course I'll give way to Mr Carson.
Finlay Carson.
I'm really surprised at intervention that what appears to be a personal attack. The decisions to postpone that meeting were taken for the best interest of the committee. And you should know, as a member of this Parliament for quite some time, it's at the discretion of the convener to set the agenda for that committee.
Minister.
Well, that's a matter for the committee, rightly. But my perspective, quite clearly, is when one of Mr Carson's members and his group comes forward and says it's this government that's delaying the legislative agenda, frankly, it's his group that are delaying the legislative agenda. Let me turn to the amendment in the name of Mr Rennie. I have to say it's somewhat circuitous and almost begrudgingly refers to EU membership. Yes. Unlike the very clear position in our motion. And I want to return to that point. I'm going to reiterate that point. I'm going to actually read out, because it's not a long motion, I'm going to read out our motion to Mr Rennie. That the Parliament notes the Scottish Government paper Building a New Scotland, an Independent Scotland in the EU, and believes that Scotland's economic... Notes the Scottish Government's paper, not necessarily supports the Scottish Government's paper, Mr Cameron, and believes that Scotland's economic, social and political future is best served by being part of the European Union. There is nothing inherent within that proposition that is inconsistent with the position, the supposed gradualist approach that Mr Rennie has laid out. Not one I agree with, but there's nothing within our motion that would delegitimise his position in being able to support our motion. I'll gladly give way to Mr Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
God, I love when the Minister gets all cute. What's really important to understand, though, is that the Minister, 7 minutes into his speech, not once has he talked about the currency. Mr Golden set out a very clear challenge to the SNP. Not once has the Minister responded to that. Will we spend years outside both the UK and the European Union under his proposal or not?
Minister.
I will turn to the issue of chronology, because I want to first come to the Labour part, because I think it's a peculiar area of attack on the process an independent Scotland would undertake to join the European Union as somehow being a weak position. But I'll come back to that. Let me turn to the Labour amendment. It's somewhat disappointing to see the proposition that has been laid out, probably predictable, though. But let's take the detail that supposedly what isn't needed is Scotland rejoining and re-engaging, being part of the European Union, but it's just a change of government. Well, let's look at what the Keir Starmer prospectus is, the number of U-turns that he has laid out on social security, where he wants to see the two-child cap and the rape clause administered more fairly, as if such a thing was possible. We've seen their U-turn on their Green pledge. We've seen the U-turn on the abolition of tuition fees in England. We know very clearly that that is not much of a proposition or a platform for change. And Ivan McKee was right to suggest that we don't know what Labour's values are, although, frankly, that might be because they have no values, as is very clearly laid out by the lack of comment by the Labour Party heading into this election. We have an opportunity I'll give way one more time to Mr. Bibby.
Mr. Hepburn for giving way. I've talked about the change that a Labour government will bring in terms of fixing the Brexit mess that the Tories have left, but also about a positive policy agenda that I outlined. What we actually need is change, because this debate has been a completely pointless debate that isn't talking about the priorities people have in terms of the cost of living crisis, the NHS crisis and many more, and it's about time we have the change of government to actually tackle the real issues that your government are ignoring.
Well, I'll come to why this debate is important in a minute. But let's look at what Anna Sawar said in 2017. The Cabinet Secretary made this point. I am the only candidate in this contest, the Labour leadership contest, who supports permanent British membership of the European Single Market and the Customs Union. I say to Mr. Sawar and his colleagues on those benches, prove it today by voting for the motion that we have laid before this Parliament. Let me turn to the issues around the motion that we have laid. I am very clear that what we have laid out in our proposition, in our paper, is a compelling case for an independent Scotland rejoining the European Union. But we've heard from others, Donald Cameron, Maurice Golden, Neil Bibby, Alec Rowley, Willie Rennie, Fazil Chowdhury, Alexander Stewart, that we should focus on the issues that matter. Our place in Europe does matter. Brexit's put additional costs on businesses and contributed to less choice. Consumers are having to pay higher prices for food, exacerbating the cost of living crisis. The London School of Economics has published a report highlighting that post-Brexit trade barriers drove one-third of the increase in food prices between December 2019 and March 2023, raising food price inflation by 8 percentage points. We've also seen the damage to our economy and a lack of investment coming into the UK and Scotland. And don't just take my perspective for arguing why this is an important matter. Mike Park, Chief Executive of Scottish White Fish Producers Association, said it is costing more and taking longer to get the fish into the continent, and there are a lot of paper trails required and red tape. Maurice Golden spoke of fantasy promises. What about that for a fantasy promise by the UK government that would be a benefit to fishing communities, the length and breadth of Scotland? An absolute fantasy from the Conservative Party.
Elizabeth Carnahan, Minister,
who relied on European trade for his cosmetics firm in Falkirk, said her business with the EU plummeted by more than 60% and it forced her to reduce her staff by half. Those aren't Scottish Government voices. Those are voices from people across Scotland setting out why this is an important issue. So the only reason there can be for opposition to our motion today, worded carefully as it is, not predicated by necessity on independence, can be that those other parties now support a Brexit. The position of the Tories, the Labour Party and even the Liberal Democrats is clear. They are born again Brexiteers. Yeah, the only way for Scotland to rejoin the European Union is by becoming an independent nation. I urge us to vote for the motion in the name of Angus Robinson.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scotland's place in the European Union. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is an announcement by the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee on People's Panel on Scottish Government Effectiveness in Consulting and Engaging the Public on its Net Zero Targets. And I call on Edward Mountain, convener of the committee, to make the announcement.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And there seems to have been quite a lot of heat in the chamber this afternoon. Let's see if I can add some light. I'm very pleased to notify you and all the members about a new People's Panel that starts its work this weekend. The panel comprises of 25 individuals, randomly selected, but reflecting the demographic balance of Scottish society. Over two intensive weekends, they will reflect on this question: how effective has the Scottish Government been in engaging the public on climate change and Scotland's climate change targets? The work of the panel advances no fewer than three strategic goals of the Scottish Parliament. Firstly, to make more use of tools of deliberative democracy, like people's panels, as recommended by the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in its report on embedding public participation in the work of the Parliament. The Net Zero is pleased to be pioneer in this area. Secondly, it promotes post-legislative scrutiny in the provisions, in this case, in the provisions of the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009, that lie behind the question that the panel is considering. We all agree that we need to do more to hold to the light laws that this Parliament has made to see how well they are actually working. The panel's work will do exactly that. Thirdly, there is the Conveners Group agreement that tracking Scottish Government progress against net zero targets is a collective priority for committees for this session. The panel's work will contribute directly to this, and I expect we will want to pay careful attention to what they tell us when the committees scrutinise the next Scottish Government's climate change plan sometime later this year. Now, this is new territory for all of us, and one thing I've learned is there is a considerable amount of time needed to prepare the ground for the panel before it even begins work. And my thanks would have to go at this stage to the parliamentary staff for their endeavours so far, particularly the Participation and Communities team. I also want to thank the distinguished members of the expert panel group, drawn from academia, business and the third sector, who have kindly given up their time to help us ensure that the panellists get a broad and balanced selection of views, data and information on their deliberative journey. Presiding Officer, I look forward to welcoming all the panellists in person to this Parliament this Friday, and the committee really looks forward to reporting back to the Parliament on their work and what we have learned about it later in the year. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. And there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Donald Cameron is agreed to, the amendments in the name of Neil Bibby and Willie Rennie will fall. And the first question is that amendment 12004.2 in the name of Donald Cameron, which seeks to amend motion 12004 in the name of Angus Robertson on Scotland's place in the European Union, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.